But without further ado, Rosamira, are you excited to get ready?
I am ready. Yes. Fantastic. Very, very excited to be here.
Well, we are excited to have you, and nice to change gears a little bit. We've done two amazing presentations in Africa, and now we are heading to South America. So Rosamira Guillen is joining us to talk about Proyecto Tití, securing a future for a critically endangered little primate today. So I love your story. We've had so many people on today who like lived and breathed nature from when they were a very little kid. They knew exactly what they wanted to do. And with you, you started off in quite a different career path and dove in with an opportunity to remodel a zoo. And now look at you here talking to us in our Global Biodiversity Festival. So
yes,
I don't want to steal your thunder. Let's dive into your presentation, hear about cotton top tamarins and all your amazing work. And thanks so much for joining us.
Amazing. It's great to be here, Jesse. I am very excited to share our story with you and my story with you, and to talk about this very cute little 1 pound monkey, Colombian, 100% like I am. So I should go on and share screen right away.
Yeah, go for it.
Okay, let me hold on. Give me a second, please.
And I think you're our only stuffed animal of the day, but we're gonna have to encourage our other speakers to have little bits for all our other animals.
Okay, so I'm lucky then. All right. Okay, so again, I'm here to talk to you about this very cute little monkey. And I'm gonna share a few stories with you. And the first one is about Julie. Julie is one of the female cotton tops, of the family groups that we study. She is the dominant female of our family group, with a very strong temper, which is very good, because for cotton tops, to be the mom of the group and the dominant female, you need to have a strong temper, because you make decisions for your family. You decide where you're going to spend the night, what tree, how do you run away, which way from predators, and how do you keep your family safe and together. So it's good that Julie has that strong character, because she can lead her family. And again, like humans, cotton tops live in family groups. So mom, dad, and the kids, right? And this is daddy. This is Vitar, is the daddy of the family group with Julie. And even though he's the cool, kind of quiet guy, that easygoing, you know, in contrast with Julie, he has a very important role for us researchers. And it is to let us find them in the forest. What he's carrying in his back is a little backpack. It's a telemetry device that sends out a signal. And our researchers here are Felix and Soto. They go into the forest every day and they pick up the signal with that antenna, and they're able to find the animals as they do their day-to-day work, understanding how they live and how these animals make a living, so we can help their conservation. And just cotton tops, like humans, as I said before, live in family groups. So if you find the daddy, if you find Bitar, you find the whole family, because they stick together just like we do. Finding the animals is very important, because we're talking about, remember, a 1 pound monkey that hangs out 30 to 40 feet above the ground on a very green, lush tropical forest in northern Colombia. So on top of that, they're very elusive to humans. So you could walk the forest for days and not find them. But, you know, that helps us find them. Here they are. I don't know if you've seen it, but they're there. They're not easy to spot. Yes, I know. You really need the binoculars. But thanks to the telemetry, we're able to find them. And we're able to learn from them, do every day, and understand how they live. That helps us promote their conservation. So Julie and Vitar are mommy and daddy. And then we have, you can hear that, maybe you can hear the chirp from the cotton top. This is Scott. Scott is one of the young adults in the family. He's like the older brother, which is weird. He hasn't left home, because just like humans, when you're a juvenile, you kind of take off, find a nice couple and make your own family, find your own territory. But Scott here has stayed in the family because he's in charge of surveillance. There's always somebody in the group that does the surveillance. Cotton tops are predated by either raptor birds that fly around the forest, or boa snakes. So Scott is always on alert, trying to make sure that his family is safe. And he uses those chirps, more than 30 different chirps that cotton tops use to communicate, just as our language. he uses them to tell their family, hey, watch out, there's some threat coming out, let's just move, go somewhere else. And then that's his role. So he's there to help his family stay safe. And then this is Angie. Angie is a young female. She was born last year, and she's there enjoying tasty fruits. Actually, that's their main diet of cotton tops. They feed from fruits, actually more than 80 species of different fruits that bloom in the forest in the different seasons. And that's actually their important role of cotton tops in the forest, is that they eat a lot, and they poop a lot too. So when they poop, those seeds come out ready to germinate. And as they move along their territory in the forest, they help plant lots of trees, probably more than what I have planted and that you guys have planted every day. So they have a very important role in the forest to keep the forest healthy and keep all those seeds rejuvenating at all the time. But sometimes they also have insects. You can see here Angie eating one kind of yucky insect, but they do. A small portion of their diet is made out of insects and also sap from the trees. They actually wait for woodpeckers to make holes in the trees, and when the sap comes out, they start licking, and they're very curious about that. So that's part of their day-to-day. Actually, it's get up, eat, take a nap, play a little, go somewhere else, take another nap, and that's a day in the life of cotton top tamarins. And this picture is very special because these are the twins that Julie, that were born in the forest just last week. This is the season, actually, April, May, June, where we get babies every year. So every dominant female in each family group has twins once a year. And those are the two babies that were born last year. So we're having a debate in our team if we should name them coronavirus. Nah, maybe not. Probably not. Not good names. Things we don't want to remember from here on. But these are our new babies, and we're very happy. We track reproduction, hormone levels from the poop, actually. And we track all of the information that allow us to understand what cotton tops need to survive into the long term. Oh, this is one baby from last year. You can hear that chirp. Just like our babies, they need to start learning how to move their own in the forest. He's not having too much of a fun time. But just as when we put our little kids to the floor and say, hey, you need to walk, you need to learn to move around. So you can see how similar to humans are these 1-pound monkeys and how much similar habits they have to our families. And that's a great educational tool for us when I talk about our awareness programs. Fortunately, and here's the sad part of this story, Julie and Vitar's home has been disappearing over the last 5-6 decades to cattle ranching and agriculture mostly. But also to fragmentation. So cotton tops hang out only on top of the trees. They never come down to the ground. So when you have landscapes like this, they cannot move from one place to another. And they need that to stay healthy and to, you know, exchange and find more resources for their families. So the main threat right now is deforestation and fragmentation, but also hunting for the pet trade. These are very cool, crazy hair, rock style animals that people don't know that much. Even our local Colombians have no idea this is such a unique species, and thus they think it's really cool to have them as pets. And that is another threat that face cotton top tamarins. The issue is that both threats, like habitat loss and capture for the pet trade, are related to the critical economic situation of our people in the rural communities in Colombia. Lack of opportunities, lacks of jobs. So we cannot say they're the bad people. They just need alternatives. And that's what I'm going to tell you a little more about later on. So those threats have put cotton tops in the verge of extinction. They are a critically endangered animal. That means they're one step away from being extinct in the wild. There's about 7,000 left in Colombia, but the forest is only like 2%. So they're cramped in little islands of forest all over the distribution area. And that has put them in a very dangerous place to be soon extinct if we don't act in their favor. And the thing is that this little monkey, it's only found in that little red dot that you see on such a big planet, only in Colombia, and not even in the whole country, but just in that little black spot within our country's map. Only there, nowhere else in Colombia or the world. So it is a very unique little monkey, and it represents a whole ecosystem that is in danger in our country. So that's why one of our main programs, besides studying the animals every day and learning from them, is protecting their forest. So we do this in many different ways. We work with environmental authorities and help them identify areas that are critical to cotton-top tamarin conservation so they can protect them and create protected areas, public protected areas. Today, we have been able over the last 10 years to designate at least 5,000 hectares of forest for cotton-tops within their distribution. But we have also purchased land to create a private reserve. So now we have, this year we hope to get at least 250 hectares of forest. It's just such a beautiful tropical place in our country. And when we say, you know, we focus on cotton tops, the work that we do, but when we're saving forest for cotton tops, we're saving forest for so many other beautiful, amazing native wildlife species in Colombia, like you saw, just a very quick sample, but we have a very biodiverse forest in the northern region of Colombia, different from the Amazon with the climate conditions, but also as diverse as the forest of the rainforest. So when we're saving the forest for cotton tops, we're saving it for all of the other animals. So we're actually saving an ecosystem. And not only that, but we're saving people because, you know, forest is a sponge for water. And just to think about one day going without water, you can see how stressful it is to not have that resource. And these guys are certainly enjoying this, you know, rain shower there. But we know water is very important for us. And we use that as one of the important ways to connect people with the importance of this forest. And we, you know, play around that concept. So even though our work with protecting the forest and studying the animals has been quite successful, we know that that's not enough to save a species. We need to work with the people and we need to have people partner with us to save our resources. So I'm gonna highlight three types of partners that we have in the local communities that will show you how we have been able to get people engaged to cotton-top tamarin conservation. And these are Salvador and Rafael, our community partners, farmers by tradition. They were displaced by the violence in our rural areas. And recently, with the signing of the peace treaty in Colombia, they were able to come back to find very wiped off landscapes, very little money to put their land to production, and very fragmented forest. So you can see, if you're a cotton top and you want to get from one forest to another, there's no way you can do it through a pasture land if you don't, you know, go down to the ground. So we started working with Salvador and Rafael and a large group of farmers and proposed to do an agreement. And this agreement, this conservation agreement, would entail for them to set aside like 10% of their land, you can see within those yellow lines, and connect one parcel with another so we can make a big corridor or like a highway, you would say, between two cities. This would be a highway for a forest between two big forest fragments, so that cotton tops and wildlife can find ways to find more resources and also, you know, a handsome male cotton top meet a beautiful, you know, female in another forest fragment and make a beautiful family. So we make these agreements in which we provide them with alternatives to invest on their land because the economic limitation is really high for them. So we provide training in, for instance, this is honey harvesting, which is a new thing, and they're doing very well with that for generating an income. We provide poultry, provide fruit trees and seeds and training to go along with that. And in exchange, they allow us to come into their land and plant trees in these corridors. So those trees in about 10 years can become large forests that animals can use. So we employ local people. These are our friends, Aldair, Luis Carlos, and Rodrigo from the local community. They're helping us in our nursery. We collect the seeds, keep a nursery, and then we go out with Salvador again and plant those trees in the corridors, and we care for them until they're old enough that they can do on their own. And you can see how fast these trees grow. We are in a very humid, hot, all year round environment. So things grow, fortunately for us. And you can see here Aldair with the machete up there with a ceiba tree that was planted 2 years ago, and it's already like 4 meters tall. So things grow fast. We go back and measure and make sure that everything is going well until we're able to see this forest grow and keep the agreement going. And what we really want to see is cotton tufts jumping from one place to another and being able to move around freely these forest fragments. So that is a big portion of the work we do with the farmers. They're very happy with it. To date, I think we're added up to 150 families around the national park and in our reserve. And there's like 95% compliance to this agreement after 4 years of being in place. So it's been very successful, of course, because it touches, the economy of the farmers, and it creates, a good agreement where you get benefits, I get benefits, everybody benefits. So that's the approach we have taken with the farmers. But there's also other people that are not farming their land. And this is a story of Anna. Anna lives in one of the communities very close to the forest as well. And she saw her family grow using forest resources for firewood, for fences, for construction, and very little opportunities to make a living once they have their families. So we came up with this crazy idea on a rainy day to crochet with plastic bags. We started collecting recycled plastic bags that unfortunately litter everywhere in the world, forests and seas and lagoons and streams. And these girls turned these bags into beautiful handbags that you can use to go to the beach or to do your shopping. And then you don't have to be using so many plastic bags. And they've started doing an economy around recycled plastic. They gather a group of artisans that right now adds up to about 50 women in different communities around the forest that live off of this. And they have been for at least the last 10 years. And they actually were awarded a few years back the Equator Prize by the United Nations. And Anna was there in Brazil receiving a prize and a cash prize as well on behalf of our colleagues, because of that beautiful work that recently has called the attention of very prestigious fashion designers in Colombia that are using plastic bags crocheted by these amazing women to show their very exclusive clients and helping the economy of these women. So with that, women like Anna have been able to build their homes and to care for their families, as many of them are single women in these local communities. And Geraldine, her older daughter, is going to college now for architecture school. So success stories of people that just needed an opportunity to find an alternative, and they have become ambassadors to the work we do and our partners in the communities to help us save the forest that they have as the backyard. So we're very happy with Anna, and some of our colleagues actually decided to go on the plush cotton tub business. Actually, my friend here is one of those that Hirlesa and the women there make as a weave. We go all over the place selling these cotton tubs, and that helps these women. Actually, that's actually a great way if you are excited to help them, is to purchase their products. You can go to our website later on and check them out. And there is delivery, domestic delivery in the US, as we keep a stock in the US for those of you that are in the States. So that's a great way to engage communities, provide income alternatives, provide options, and they become your best allies for protecting wildlife. And my last story is another side of our partnership with communities, our education. This is Nelson. Nelson was 13 when we met him. When we came to his school in one of the communities with this story about cotton tufts. He had grown right by the forest and never knew that cotton tufts were only found in our country. He got really, really excited and happy. He was the first one to participate in all of our activities. We took him and his class to the forest to see the monkeys. They used the antenna, they found the animals and learned everything about, you know, we do in the forest. And he was completely in love with this. He, of course, joined all of our programs after that one. And you can see them there in the center below as part of our TT leaders. And in that program, they learned to make their own projects at home and also in their communities. So he and Renzo here and his friends, they did this huge recycling campaign and collected about 2 tons of recycled material, teaching their neighbors the importance of cotton tops and protecting and reducing pollution and protecting the forest. Nelson even convinced his teachers at school to do his last year's social work, teaching the Cartitilla, our program, to kids in his community and his school. He persuaded them, and he's a very intense kid, so he did get it. So, and he was one of the first ones to join us at the annual celebration of the Day of the Cotton Top Tamarins, where you can see here in Colombia, we're big on dancing, on music, we love folklore. And this is the kind of activities that kids love to engage in. And this is what we do on the Day of the Cotton Tops. We celebrate cotton tops and dance, music, art, and it's a lot of fun every year in August. So we helped Nelson get a 2-year degree in environmental management. And he actually did his internship with us in the forest, tracking the monkeys. Look at that forest. When it rains, it floods, it pours. But he loved it. He basically had it in his heart. And from a little kid at 13 years old, Nelson is now at 23. One of the interpreters and one of the biggest zoos in Bogota, in Colombia. And he is our best ambassador for telling people about cotton top tamarins. So basically what we wanna do is just spark in kids this love for nature. And if they have it in themselves, help them develop to become leaders, the kinds of leaders we need in the communities and in our countries to protect our wildlife and to spread the message. So I have shared with you our work with the farmers, our work with the artisans, and our work with the kids and the students in the communities. And these are the 3 types of partnerships that we implement in the communities to get people engaged with cotton top tamarin conservation. So our model is basically combining different approaches to reduce threats for cotton tops, doing research in the forest, protecting beautiful ecosystem where cotton tops live, educating the new generation of Colombians that will help us protect our resources, and helping communities make a decent living, sustainable living, so they all become our partners to protect cotton top tamarins. I need to acknowledge my team. These are the people that day to day collaborate with the artisans, with the farmers, with the kids, with the research, with the forest protection. It's a teamwork, and they are very passionate, dedicated, and committed people. So my best to them, and they're the motor of what we do every day. And please, if you enjoyed this conversation, this is our social media. You will see amazing videos in our YouTube page, and you can follow us on social media and keep in touch with us. Or if you want to learn more about us, you're more than welcome to contact us through our website or through our social media. Thank you so much for listening. And if there's time, I'm not sure how I'm doing, Jesse, with time, I would love to answer any questions you may have.
You are doing fantastically, and what a beautiful presentation. If ever there was a presentation that summed up all the lessons we've learned today in the Global BioFest, it was that. That was beautiful. And for everyone online, we're going to end screen share soon, but do get that information for social media, the website. You can buy some of those amazing products, learn more about what Proyecto Tití is doing, and learn more about those stories. And so, Rosamira, if you want to come out of screen share so we can see you for a few questions, that would be fantastic.
Yes.
I want to start with, your presentation was unique in today in that you really personified not only the animals, but you put names to the people that you're supporting in the community that are doing such great work for you. Now, it might seem obvious on why you do that, but it certainly inspired me, but why highlight that? Why give the monkeys names? Why, really drive home with individual stories as opposed to this collective?
Well, for us, when we're doing our research, it's very important that we're able to identify the animals. because we collect information on behavior, reproduction, interactions, presence in the group, what they eat, what they what role they have in their family. So in order to do that, you have to do annual captures to put the transmitters so we can find the animals. And we mark little bits of their white hair so we can identify. They all look alike, you know, big hair and the size is about the same. But our team, you know, every day in the forest, you kind of learn to identify them. And that's very important. So we collect information personalized by each individual. So it is very important that we're able to identify them. And it's also fun because we have learned that they do have personalities, that they do behave differently. And very much like us humans, they are different within their own species. So we learn from behavior as well. And we learn on those interactions that are critical for us to promote their conservation. For instance, all of the forest restoration work we are doing is basically supported on all what we have learned. So we know what kinds of trees need to be in this forest. We know what kinds of heights of forest, how the distribution of the forest. It's all very important for us to be able to replicate all of what cotton tops need and make sure they make it in the long term.
Fantastic. What a great answer. I love this idea of highlighting, again, individual stories. Now, you know, we've been highlighting backyard bio all day today. I remember as a kid watching a stream of ants, 100 ants with brains that could fit on the end of a pin, and they acted differently if you put a piece of grass in front of them. And so I think that highlighting things, especially as intelligent as monkeys, is a really important way of fostering, you know, that sort of conservation connection that we're looking for with this program and what you guys are looking for with your amazing organization.
It is nice too, because every time you go into the forest, it's like a soap opera, you know? Yeah. It's like you kind of follow what's going on with this group and with that, who's pregnant, who left the house, who's misbehaving, you know? It's kind of fun. But yeah,
I have to do a follow-up on this because, you know, tracking down these little primates in the forest, as you mentioned, is a difficult endeavor. Now, every time we do primate talks, it's like a multi-hour journey out into the woods. Is there a sense of, you know, every morning they get up, they've got the receiver. How long does it take them to find the family?
Well, they go into the forest usually at 7:30 because cotton tops are only diurnal. Yep. So they take a walk like about 40 minutes from the field station to the forest. So it's not that bad. And they usually find the groups in within 15, 20 minutes because they get the signal. So that antenna, basically the signal gets stronger when you're close to the animals. And once they find them, they sit down for 20, 40 minutes, depending, and take notes every 2 minutes on an iPad of what cotton tops are doing. And they again, you know, walk another half an hour and find another group and do the same thing. So they spend probably 5 to 6 hours. Every day, and they alternate the groups every day, so they have, because it's hot and it's humid, and when you come out, it's hot, so you need to be hydrating and be taking snacks to kind of keep it going.
There's Rosamira's lesson for everyone tuning in at home. When you go into the Colombian rainforest to go for monkeys, bring a big jug of water.
Drink a lot of water, yes.
What I think we're going to do too, and we are approaching the end of the broadcast, unfortunately, even though we could talk all day, is what I'll do is we should put your team in touch with all the people we work with who track chimpanzees in the woods where it takes them those 8 hours. And maybe your team is just really, really efficient trackers. And we'll have to, we'll do some cross conservation collaborations here. But Rosamira, this has been a real pleasure. Thank you so much for sharing your story with us today.
Thank you, Jesse. Thank you to everybody in the audience. Thanks, Joe. And it's a pleasure. You know, you have our contact information. We'll be happy to get in touch with us and share more of our story. Or if you want to help, we're here.
Outstanding. Well, thank you so much.